An election late this year, or as early as March, is an idea that's been shot down repeatedly by the Prime Minister today, leaving a May election as the more likely timing. But Australians could be forgiven if they feel like an election campaign is already underway. Scott Morrison has hit the road in Queensland this week with a bus bearing his face and ScoMo scrawled on the side.
Yeah, unfortunately for the Liberal Party, though, this bus has already become an internet meme. Some certainly comedy value here with Aussies being brutal, updating the bus with slogans like this and this and this. ScoMo's farewell tour, the last one there. Yeah, the internet's certainly having fun because we're noticing this hyper-casual style that Scott Morrison is adopting. Fair dinkum, you might say. Stephen Sheila is the digital CEO, former Facebook Australia CEO, and John Winning, CEO of The Winning Group, and joining us both for taking stock tonight. Thank you to you both. Stephen, I want to start with you. What do you think about ScoMo, the casual PM? Do you like the style?
Well, my opinion of the style, I think, is irrelevant. Probably what's more relevant is what you're seeing here is this theme of authenticity that's coming out in politicians all around the world. It started a few years ago with the rise of social media back in the age of Obama and Kevin Rudd, but now it's really getting to sort of hyperscale. So you've got to express this sense of authenticity when you're a politician or any sort of business leader. And sometimes that's open to ridicule. So that's what you're seeing now.
Yeah.
But do you think it's going to be effective? You know, this overt, kind of over-the-top desire to kind of connect with people.
Well, it's a viral hit, right? It's a viral hit. Does that mean it's a success?
Well, people are talking about it, right? You know, people are talking about it. And some would say, you know, it is, hey, some of this stuff is trivial. And the truth is, as long as it's not a lot of negativity that's going on, it's going to be forgotten. It's just going to be dust in the wind, right? There'll be the next thing next week or tomorrow. So in that sense, he probably is winning. But probably the bigger thing to ask is, you know, what's the intention of this strategy? And it's probably not aimed necessarily at, you know, your average voter. It's aimed at specific people. So they're trying to create an image for him or project an image of him towards specific voters that they're trying to sway.
John?
Yeah, I guess for me, I share a slightly different angle at this. And I think it's probably sad that this is where politicians have to put themselves to get the votes today, and I think it's probably going to be more effective than what we even saw in the US because of the compulsory voting. And I, you know, I've got friends in their 20s and 30s that probably get 100% of their news off social media.
Yeah.
And I think that it's really sad that our politicians have to put this, if we call it authentic kind of side across to try and appeal to someone who has absolutely zero interest in political views and agendas, and they're just trying to win votes on sculling a beer.
Yeah, people debating whether that would win in the election. Scott Morrison was also mocked after posting a fair dinkum tribute to surfer Mick Fanning's mum on social media. Did you miss that one? Have a look.
G'day, Elizabeth. Mick Fanning's mum. Thanks very much for the hat. We're here at the Gold Coast down at Broadbeach. And yeah, fair dinkum. We should be supporting Australian businesses. So great to have the Rip Curl hat. Appreciate you pointing it out. I'll be wearing it proudly as I move around the country along with many others that are similar. So thanks to Mick Fanning's mum, Elizabeth, and all the best to Mick.
Say Mick Fanning multiple times. I think he wanted to let us know that he knows Mick Fanning.
Wanted to say fair dinkum.
I don't know, is it authentic? Is it actually really overdone and hard to believe?
He's not an actor, right? I mean, that's maybe
all politicians are actors, right?
I'll put the question to you as an Australian. Is that what you want your Prime Minister doing?
Well,
is this what we want our Prime Minister spending his time doing? Making viral videos to Australians claiming he knows celebrity.
I think the reality is, though, for any democracy now, that is part of what you have to do. It's part of the role as being a politician is projecting this image, whether we like it or not.
Well, we learned on radio today he had his first pash up at the Central Coast in Lake Munmorah, so that was also part of the development.
Did anybody need to know that? Prime Minister?
What's the boundaries here? I mean, where does it all go? I mean, he's trying to say, you know, he's not very romantic, but his first bit, you know, where's the boundaries here? How far does this go?
I think with the current system, that's where they've got to be, like you said, whether you like it or not. If you want to win votes, if you want to win an election, that's where you've got to be. That's where the voters are, and that's unfortunately what their interests are.
Mm. Do you think that there'll be a kind of a swing backwards, you know, this kind of idea of the statesman in the, you know, incurability, this idea of you're wearing a Cooper and not a trucker's hat and you don't need to do all this sort of thing? I mean, do you think that we'll kind of...
Malcolm Turnbull ate his pie with a knife and fork,
right?
That's true. ScoMo was like munching into it.
Well, maybe that was too far the other way. I just wonder if we're kind of, you know, if we lower the bar, if people are going to desire for it to be kind of raised again.
I think we're entering a new age, though. And right now we're in the transition between one age and another.
Yeah.
The pre-social media, all of us up here, we're pre-social media beasts, essentially. And now we're moving to an age where everybody's born in social media. And I think there'll be a new model of statesman that emerges in that new social media world.
Right. So we're just not sure what it is yet, you reckon?
we're going through the transition now, and I don't think we can really recognize it. And I think with this specific issue, come back in 2 weeks, we'll be talking about something else. This will go away. But I think the bigger theme is that, you know, the leaders of tomorrow and the leaders from now on actually have to have some sort of public profile that lives in social media.
But you guys must think about this all the time as well. You want to offer something personal, but, you know, there's still...
I think that hopefully the ridiculousness of things like that viral video that our Prime Minister's doing will force a medium to long-term system change. I mean, medium to long-term in politics might be a decade, 2 decades away, but I think that we'll see the wrong leaders probably getting in and spending way too much time on completely, you know, inefficient things for in terms of the Australian economy, and hopefully it forces a change in the system.
Mm. Well, that'd be interesting to see. Another thing that we wanted to talk about with you guys is the consumer price breakdown. Now, it kind of feels like it comes out of nowhere, but we've been talking, and there's a weekly report on how the consumer is feeling, and we've seen recently how inflation numbers are going. CommSec today put together some interesting numbers about what has happened in the last decade when it comes to consumer things that we all buy, basically, and we've got a graphic here to show what they've come across, and it's a bit small, but what you can see there is that things like sports equipment and outdoor activity gear, that's right up the top. That's barely changed, relatively speaking, in the last decade. Now, way down the bottom in blue, that's the stuff that's gotten really cheap over the last decade. We're talking about consumer tech predominantly, which is apparently 70%, relatively speaking, less now than it was 10 years ago. Now, I'm really interested in this. John, you're somebody who makes a living in selling appliances online, of course. Yeah. So, I mean, how important is that sort of thing to you? I mean, the way the consumer feels about buying an appliance, they feel like it's cheaper than it used to be.
I mean, I think that you always play, you know, to the rules of the game, well, the cards that you're dealt is probably a better way of looking at it. And unfortunately, TVs go from being $10,000 a few years ago to being $500 this year. It's just the game that we've got to play. We've got to keep adapting ourselves and finding new opportunities to sell things to make up that gap in revenue and profits. But from our point of view, it's inevitable. I mean, how far can it go? I'm not sure. But certainly, you know, maybe to a point where people don't have TVs anymore and they're consuming all of their content on their mobile device. So maybe it goes from $10,000 a decade ago to maybe it's zero and people just don't buy LCD, LED TVs, and we've got to keep evolving ourselves. I think it's really driven by demand and volume, but also the move in China. I think, you know, they can manufacture these things so much cheaper. The raise in trades to get these types of products repaired would cost you more to repair a 42-inch TV, plasma or LED TV today than it would be to buy a new one. And that obviously drives more and more volume, which means they can make them cheaper and cheaper.
Which is maybe part of the story too, because Chris and I were saying, well, people are expecting things to be cheaper, but we are spending more money on things like services. And you can't, you know, the service guy to come fix that TV is probably going to cost more.
And I can tell you there's less and less of them. We're in the trade.
Yeah, right.
We have electricians, plumbers, handymen that work for us to install all the products that we do. And we've talked about whether we could go into servicing for out-of-warranty servicing for our customers of the products. It is almost impossible to get those types of trades. That's the reason we're not in it.
Yeah. What's the story from these numbers for you?
Well, I looked at that data, and what you see that's apparent is the things that have really dropped in price are those that are either manufactured overseas in our global markets, things like electronics, or things that are just manufactured overseas and they've moved to cheaper labor areas, so like clothing and apparel and shoes have moved out of Australia to other countries. But what's really interesting is to see the drop in the price of consumer electronics. And what's profound about that is things aren't just getting cheaper, but they're getting so much better, right? The qualities of the TVs and the phones and the computers we have today, and the not just the power of them, but their ability to do things that they couldn't do even 10 years ago. Now, you know, your phone today is your gateway to the internet, it's your gateway to the world, your social media, your search, your email, everything's on your phone. Even 10 years ago, we were just at the dawn of that. So we've entered a whole new space where these devices aren't just cheaper, but they're changing our lives.
So do you then look at a company like Apple and go, that is a stunning achievement to be able to keep on getting us to pay $2,000+ for a new iPhone, despite what we see in consumer tech prices
more
broadly?
Sure, yeah. I mean, Apple has done an amazing job of creating a luxury brand around what is a commodity item. But that's taken them decades to do, and they've been very true to that brand over those years. But Apple has a challenge ahead of them, which is what's the next big thing, and they haven't gotten that since the iPhone.
It's not the new color.
No,
the new size. The new size.
It's the new device, and we haven't seen that yet. We don't know if it's a TV, a connected home, a car. They're working on it. It wasn't the watch. The watch was very small. It may be some other form of wearable, but that'll be the next sort of trend in consumer products.
Maybe implantable.
Yeah, that's happening in some.
I feel like we're going to go implantables before we go back to Google Glass and that type of thing.
Yeah, that was a bit nice, wasn't it?
Google Glass just
died, didn't it, really?
Well, it died. It had a few things, I think, that were wrong. It was a little bit ahead of its time.
Yeah.
But I think we will see a comeback with some of these augmented reality devices over the next few years.
Let's talk about Melbourne Cup just very quickly. The race that stops the nation in business stopped the bookies. I don't know if you guys saw today. All the bookies, well, the couple of the major ones.
Was there a race today, really?
Yeah, exactly. We didn't notice. We'll look at the RBA statement, so give us a break. A couple of these sites went down for the bookies, which would come at great cost. What do you guys think about, I just feel like this happens all the time, whether it's retailers putting on, spending blitzes online, it fails. We had the My Health Records opt-out, the hotline, that went down today. Mm. We had Telstra outages on the weekend. We had the census fail. I mean, what goes on that they know this is going to be their biggest day of the year and they have systems failures like that? I don't get it.
Appliances online. We grew up in an era where you're kind of physical infrastructure that you own and you have ability to scale to a certain degree before you crash. And unfortunately, when you have things like you go on, say, a television program that might be peak hour and you get this huge spike and our site used to go down and we'd have our last day of our sale, our traffic would spike and our site would go down. But now in the day of cloud computing, if you're properly set up, this stuff shouldn't happen. I mean, they should be set up. They should have a reasonable idea of how much traffic they're going to get on Melbourne Cup and have an infrastructure that is able to scale to that. And so I think it's just poor planning.
Not much sympathy there.
It happens all the time.
Well, it seems to happen all the time, but there's thousands of instances every day. It doesn't happen. We see the highest profile ones. And, a bookie goes down on Melbourne Cup Day, you're going to hear about it.
Yeah, sure.
I'm sure they didn't plan for that to happen.
Click frenzy, all the retailers.
What I'm thinking of. It doesn't help. I mean, that back in June, they were giving Optus a bit of slack on Twitter because of Optus's problems with the World Cup. And there's like the tweet that's screenshotted of them giving. Anyway, so that happens to everyone, it seems. One other thing, guys, Matthew McConaughey's revealed that he missed out on the role of Jack in the Titanic. So his big devastation in life, of course we know it went to Leo DiCaprio, it was one of the most famous movies of all time. Do you have any work-life equivalents, you guys, that the role that you could have had, the lights
regrets
that you could have enjoyed, regrets?
Ironically, maybe mine was actually being an actor. Because when I was a much younger man and I was in a couple of films just as an extra.
Really?
And my father is an actor back in the States. He still is, he's almost 90 years old. He's still on camera, on film. So I think acting was in my blood and I toyed with the idea for a while, but never went that way.
You didn't do it.
Maybe I could have been in
Titanic. Yeah, I was going to say, you could have been on Titanic.
Jack, yeah,
wow,
that's
you
right.
Could have been Jack.
Yeah. I won a world championship in sailing in 2001, my last year of school. And after that, I sailed for a couple more years and then ended up giving it up to start appliances online because startups obviously need 100% focus. And the person that got second to me in that world titles went on to win a gold medal for Australia. So he's
there
probably a much better sailor than me, but I can have him on his day. Maybe one out of 10 times I'll beat him and that was the one, but he did go on to win a gold medal. So maybe it would have been Olympic sailing or something like that.
You can relate.
Yeah.
Mine's far less exciting, but I did have the choice at one point in my life whether I was to choose a career as a professional clarinetist.
Oh my goodness.
But I got a job in the Seven newsroom doing a job and I had to decide Saturdays, do I go to orchestra or do I go into media? It's lonely, the clarinet playing in a spare room. It's a bit strange, actually.
Oh, it's a big question. I also read that Will Smith had the opportunity to be Neo in The Matrix, but he was too busy doing Wild Wild West. Have you guys ever heard of that movie?
That was a bit of a...
See, there you go. Versus The Matrix. I mean, that's another...
Yeah. What a decision.
Top that, Will Smith. Well, look, it was certainly not anywhere near Stephen's experience, but I was an extra too in a TV show called Rush a few years ago. You probably saw my left shoulder. I certainly would not have made it. In fact, I turned up, I was about 20, and I had facial hair as I do now, and they said, oh, you're going to be a cop, you can't have facial hair, so they shaved me, and then they go, oh, geez, you look about 14, we can't have you now. So that was a disaster. But no, I was never in any danger of being
I just worked out why Chris still likes her facial hair on TV.
Because I will look 14.
That was a deep psychic insight into it.
I have the same problem, don't worry.
Yeah, so there you go.
We're deep into the minds of you guys now. Thank you very much, Stephen, Sheila, and John Whitting. Appreciate your time tonight here on Your Money Live.